become my sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end, and you could have it all. My empire of dirt, if I could start again a million miles away, I would keep myself. I would find a way.
There we go. Can you hear me now? Perfect. Thank you so much for Pastor Appreciation. I don't deserve it. Don't want it. Listen, you guys, that lady right there that stands behind that piano named Katrina is 100% incredible. And she is a backbone of this church. And I love her. And I y'all keep her happy, because every time we talk, I say, if you go, I go. So... we're a combination. And Holly Murphy, has we've worked side by side for 21 years, almost 22 years. So it's wonderful having longevity with somebody. And I thank you for everything. I see a lot of dots, which I'm pumped about. The man trip brought me a paddle back from the man camp, and I really appreciate it. All of them signed it. The only problem is it's hanging in my office this week, and I have PTSD because in elementary school... Y'all boys don't know about that. They talked about your feelings. They beat my feelings out of me. And my principal, she drilled holes in it so it would whistle. Spow! And then I'd come home, and my dad, he didn't care about my feelings. He just beat me more. It was ridiculous. Welcome to New Covenant. If you're a visitor, fill out a connect card. We'd love you to fill one out. And here we go. Now they only work half a day a week, I know. Here we go. Got your Bibles, go to Ecclesiastes. We're in Ecclesiastes 2, and I thank you so much for being here in this study. Last week, man, I had so many conversations about speaking out of Ecclesiastes, and it's the thing I love about this book, and the thing I think that's the realness of this book, is this book, I said it last week, is holding up a mirror to our soul. There is no one in this room or watching online that can study Ecclesiastes 1 or 2 and not find or see somewhere in this book there's their heart. You'll see your heart. You'll see your humanity in this. And this book, as we studied last week, was written by Solomon, known as the wisest man to ever live. He actually had an opportunity in 1 Kings where God came to him, and he did what we all kind of dream of God doing. He was kind of like a genie in the bottle and said, ask, whatever you ask, I'll give you. And Solomon, I believe, in his wisdom, who he asked for more wisdom. He asked to be the wisest man so that he could rule the people. And he didn't ask for himself, he asked for other people, and it pleased God. And God made him the wisest man to ever live. And Solomon was the son of David, so he inherited the kingship of Israel. And Solomon built one of the most unbelievable kingdoms that the world has ever seen. And to this day, it's still talked about. To this day, it's still got enemies wanting to take it off the planet. And it's still there, and Solomon helped build and orchestrate this. But Solomon, just like every one of us in this room, just like all of humanity, Genesis 3 gets us all. Genesis 3 is somewhere in all of our lives, and it's a thing called sin. It's a thing called walking away from God's will and what we were created to be. And Solomon did that. And we see the wisest man in the world became greedy. He became self-centered. He became an idolater. He became actually violent at some points. And that's what leads me to this first question I have for you guys. Before we go any further, I've got a question for you guys, because I really started thinking about this week. We walk in church every single Sunday morning, or we walk around in our daily lives, or come into Wednesday night Bible study or at ball games, and people ask you how you're doing, and you say, you're a good Southerner. You say, fine, fine, good. We're doing good. Good, good. How mama doing down there? You know, like you get through it, right? But if the wisest man to ever live who was son of David, the man after God's own heart, fell to sin, why don't we repent more? Why is repentance not part of our culture more? Why is it not part of your life more? Many of us, we repent when we're 7, we get baptized in the camp lake, and then that's the last time we ever think about repentance. Guys, here's what Ecclesiastes does. It's going to show you you're not good. You're not good. In fact, we're all struggling with something. We're all dealing with some type of sin, whether that sin is something we brought onto ourselves or someone else has brought into our lives. We're all struggling with it. And for us to act like we're better than the wisest man to ever live, come on, y'all. Seriously? So, as we study this week, let's just be honest. Let's just open our hearts to be honest to what's in these two chapters. What's in these two chapters? The fall, the sin of man. Listen, I know last week might have been tough. We go through Ecclesiastes 1, and Solomon's pulling no punches. He's like, it's vanity. It's meaningless. Everything's meaningless. And he just keeps naming these things. They're meaningless. And so you're like, that was just tough. Well, I got bad news. That's all he says today, too, okay? Like, chapter 2 is just the same thought. It's just one long thought. And we're going to see this, Solomon saying these things. But I want to be honest with you. I think some of us last week, those like myself that are a little bit older. By the way, can we bring that picture up of my family? This has been disturbing to me. Every time this picture comes up, one, my children are gorgeous. Like, they're awesome. And my wife, wow. Like, good job there, babe. You look good. No one tell her how pretty she is. And she's wearing snakeskin shoes this morning. I see you, girl. All right, anyway. She ain't even looking at me. She will not look at me right now. But look how old I am. Has anybody else ever seen a picture of yourself and you went, that's not me. I'm not that old. Like, I was like, when did my pawpaw hang out with my family? That's the first thing I thought when I saw that. But listen, if you're like me and you've got some years on you, you've experienced life a little bit, you walk away from last week with Solomon and this is what you thought, right? That makes sense. That makes sense. Because last week, the question that I tried to unpack and answer for you in Ecclesiastes 1 was, what really matters? What really matters? And what really matters to me in my life is Jesus Christ and that picture. That's what really matters to me, and I'm content with both. And that's what I tried to answer through Scripture, and Solomon was saying, this is what matters. And us that are a little bit older, we saw that, and we said, you know, we understood that. But for young men, you know what young men heard last week? Nah, that ain't me. Right? You remember being young and it didn't affect you? You know, you remember being young and like, I'm not going to do that? You remember being young and the pastor telling you, you can make as much money in the world, but you'll never find happiness. And you were like, let me try, right? It's like when people say, money doesn't bring happiness. And I'm like, I ain't never had a jet ski. Money brings jet skis. I see myself being happy on a jet ski, right? It's a Kevin James joke. But like, But literally, contentment is what Solomon lays out for us. And today I want to unpack through these 26 verses of Ecclesiastes 2. If what really matters is our contentment, then what is our contentment for? I believe the wisest man to ever live lays that out for us. He says, I said in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasures. Enjoy yourself. But behold, this also was vanity. I said of laughter, it is mad, and of pleasure, what use is it? What is it really for? That's what he's asking. Matt Chandler, a pastor in Texas, said that we all subscribe to the philosophy that ultimately satisfaction is in more of what we already have. All of us believe in some way, if we're honest with ourselves, that if we just have a little bit more, we'd be happy. Rockefeller once famously said when they asked him how much money does he need, he said just one more dollar. We all just want more. We just want more happiness, more time, more money, more things we really already have. But somehow we think that if we can just get more, then we're going to find this happiness, this meaning. But nothing ultimately satisfies. Solomon in Ecclesiastes is laying out that he's done it all. He's been there and all. He's looked under every rock. He's knocked on every door. And it all still left him empty. And that's what we're about to read. So my first point, if you're taking notes, is more pleasure, more problems. It was going to be more money, more problems, but I felt like it was a little too soon. That's a Puff Daddy thing for some of y'all. You're like, who's Puff Daddy? That's P. Diddy. Who's that? That's Sean Combs. Who's that? That's the guy that's in big trouble. And he's in big trouble because if you look, he's a little bit, got a little Solomon in him. He chased after everything. He chased after money. He chased after pleasure. He chased after everything. And where's he at now? And Solomon was saying it's all vanity. See, Solomon lovingly here tries to, he's chasing this thing. And I don't know if this is the first time you've heard this, but I want to be honest with you. But the American dream will leave you empty. Because American dream says if you just get a little more, you'll be happy. But look at Marilyn Monroe. Was she happy? Look at Kurt Cobain. Was he happy? Look at Robin Williams. Look at verse 2. It says, the laughter's foolish. It's madness. Robin Williams, one of the funniest men ever lived, died empty. Solomon knew and understood this, that more pleasures equal more problems. He said in verse 3, as we continue, I search in my heart how to cheer my body with wine. My heart still guiding me with wisdom and how to lay hold of folly till I might see what is good for the children of man to do under the heavens during the few days of their life. Many people, many of us in this room, we chase pleasures for our ultimate meaning. The things that we use to distract ourselves from life become our main purpose of life, just to distract ourselves because we know that we don't have purpose. Because we've not surrendered to Christ and His goodness and who God is. That we've placed our purpose in things that we think are going to please us. And as long as we're pleasing ourselves, we're happy. But that's not where it comes from. Now, I do understand that as we read this, some of you, when you read that word wine, you have a lot of Baptists in you, so you got real nervous. But there's no doubt that alcohol is a controversial topic, but let's look at what the Bible says. Let's look what the Bible says in a whole, especially in Ecclesiastes. When you get into chapter 9, chapter 10, Solomon said that alcohol and wine was intended for joyous occasions, for good things. But see, here's the thing. You know what has happened with alcohol? We as humans, what we've done is we've taken something that was intended for good and we've made it evil. We've corrupted it. The Bible is super, very clear that being drunk and being out of control is a sin. And I am not staying up here giving you freedom and permission to sin and bring detriment to your family. Alcohol, to be honest with you, is evil and it's a killer. But here's why. It's because we use it for the wrong things. It's like everything we're about to go through, none of it is bad. It's just it can't be your God. It just can't be what you're using. It can't be what you're looking for it to be. Here's the problem when we're using things of our pleasure to satisfy ourselves and not glorify God. We have taken God off His throne and placed ourselves on because the ultimate goal of those things is to bring us pleasure. That is not what we are called to be. We are image bearers. We are not the image. So the problem with alcohol and all these things we're going to read through tonight is that what we've done is we've replaced God with ourselves and we've used those things to bring us something. And here's the thing, you can use them, use them, use them, use them, use them. You can go after all of them. And you know what Solomon says? They will leave you empty. They will leave you wanting more. Look at verse 6 and 7. He talks about pleasure brings more problems. And then I'm talking about in verse 4 and 6. He says, I made great works. I built houses. I planted vineyards for myself. I made myself gardens and parks and planted in all kinds of fruit trees. I made myself pools from the water, the forest, and growing trees. Here's what he said. He said, projects. Projects. So what he did is he took projects and he said, you know what? These pleasures aren't bringing it for me. I'm going to start building stuff. Right? Hey, do y'all remember the pandemic? Do you remember two stores that didn't close, Lowe's and Home Depot? Do you want to know why? You want to know why? Because we couldn't control what was going on with the virus, so we started building decks and remodeling kitchens and redoing bathrooms and refinishing. Like, you know why? Because we could control that. But here's a problem. It leaves us empty. I mean, look what Solomon did. He starts talking about the things that he did. Listen, in First Kings, if you go study 1 Kings 5 and 6, Solomon built God's temple. He built the house of the Lord. He built this just beautiful. The world had never seen the beauty of this temple. And then he started building these palaces and these gardens and these vineyards and these orchards. And then to water them, he built these pools. Well, I got pictures. Listen, Solomon's pools, that's Israel today. Those are Solomon's pools. 3,000 years ago, those pools were built. Because he was smart enough to know that he needed to use those for agriculture. He built swimming pools that are still there today. 3,000 years later, his swimming pool is there. Your above ground pool won't be there next summer, maybe. You know? I mean, think about this. The man who built something that lasted 3,000 years is still saying all these projects are meaningless. Listen, he built God's temple, and then he decided to build his own house. It took him 13 years to build his own house. It took me and my wife about 13 months to build our house. It took him 13 years. Y'all remember he had 700 wives. How do you pick out finishings with 700 wives? I mean, think about that. I want copper. I want black. 13 years to build, and it was bigger than the temple. Look at verse 7 and 8. He starts saying, I bought male and female slaves. I had slaves who were born in my house. I had also great possessions of herds and flocks, more than any who had been before me in Jerusalem. I also gathered for myself silver and gold and treasures of the king. I got singers. You like The Voice? He had The Voice in his house. He had male and female singers come and sing him something, whatever he wanted to. He had it all. He had more property than any of us combined. And it was meaningless. Look, when you start studying, truly like looking through the property he had and the people, he said, I had male and female slaves. He had slaves, but he also had people he employed. Maybe you're in here and you're a business owner and you're like, if I could grow my business, I would be happier. We'd be more comfortable. He had 30,000 employees, not slaves, employees. He had one guy that was a cupbearer. His whole job was to pour water in his mouth. Could you imagine? What do you do for a living? He threw a party. For the whole nation, he served 22,000 cows, not steaks. See, some of you were like, oh, he did a steak dinner for everybody. No, he did a cow dinner for you. Get a cow. You get a cow. How much meat is that? He bankrupted the silver economy of the time. Solomon got so much and gathered so much, he bankrupted. When you look at his value, it said that he had $1 billion just in gold. Now, he's worth $2.2 trillion. He had $1 billion just in gold. If you look at his daily, he made $2,740 a day. His wife never once called him and said, don't swipe the card. I mean, he had it all. And he says, it was meaningless. 9 through 11, he says, so I became great and surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem. All my wisdom remained with them. Whatever my eye desired, I did not keep from it. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found pleasure in my toil, and this is my reward. Then I considered all that I had, hands had done in my toil, and I had spent it in doing it. And behold, all was vanity, striving after the wind. And there was nothing to gain under the sun. Solomon concludes this area of pleasure basically by saying he denied himself nothing. If he wanted it, he got it. If he saw it and he liked it, it was his. He denied himself nothing. And he says there it was like striving after the wind. He was like, what does it matter? What does it matter? I'm going after, but I can't hold it. There's nothing there. It left him. He had all the things. He had the success. He was the wisest man. He had the best houses. He had the most possessions. He lived a life of the lifestyles of the rich and famous. For some of you, that's called cribs, all right? Some of the two different generations, right? But he had it all, right? He had the finest of everything. He threw the best parties. He had the greenest lawns. He had the best servants. He had more money than he ever needed. He had a military. He was popular. He had a blue check mark beside his name. He had endless entertainment. He indulged himself in everything, and he's saying, I was empty. I was empty. Now, I was thinking about this week. Many of you live in Alamance County or the greater Alamance County area. So when I say all of this, you say, Brian, I don't want that. Like, I don't need all those things. I don't need a bigger house. That's just more to clean. I don't need bigger jars. That's just more to take care of. Like, I'm very content with what I have. So, you know, I understand. I've learned from Solomon. I don't really chase after these things. But then I start thinking about, you know what we do really well here in Alamance County? You know what I do really well? I work really, really hard so that later in life I won't have to work. Same thing. Same exact thing. Like, I'm going to work really, really hard so I don't have to work. But that's what he's saying. He's like, you can strive after that, but then when you get there, you can spend your whole life building this thing up so that one day you can take that trip. But then it's like, what are you going to lose for that trip? Are you content in the moment you're called to be? Remember last week, the contentment idea. Look at verse 10, though. I put it up here in the New Living Translation because this verse, real quick, I'm gonna get real teachy on you. You ready? This verse goes after the American dream, the American worldview that we all have. All of us have it in here. Let's just be honest. We all have it. We watch our culture fight over it all the time, okay? In this verse, Solomon says both of them are a waste of time. He says, anything I wanted, I would take. I denied myself no pleasure. This is a worldview that we have in America that if there's something you want, you should have it. If your feelings say you need that, you should have it. If you feel like you should have health care, well, then the government, we should just give you health care, right? You feel like you should be able to, it's your body, your choice. You can do whatever you want to. So there you go. It's going to leave you empty. Hey, we believe that, you know what, I want to go to college. Well, then somehow somebody should give it to you. You should not, it's yours. There you go. It's this mindset that we have in our culture. If we want it, if it's going to bring us pleasure, it's going to make us happy, then we deserve it. But the problem is, at the end of the day, we're empty. But see, here's another one, though. He says that, but then he says, I even found great pleasure in hard work. Now we're talking about the other side, right? Right? The reward was my pleasure. That this viewpoint we have in America is this: if I work hard, then it's mine and I can do what I want with it. Right? It's mine. You can't take it from me. It's mine. See, the problem with both of these views is they're not biblical. Because the Bible says everything belongs to God. You should steward it for His glory. That's what the Bible says. You work really hard so that God can bless you. And now that He blesses you, you use it for His glory. You want something? Go for it. There's nothing wrong with having dreams and desires. Go for it. We're all set up here. I need to dream bigger. I met with an architect this week. I'm going big. But you know what? Here's the thing. It's like, he says it can't be about that. And here's the thing. When it comes, y'all saw my beautiful children, me and my wife, our beautiful children. Listen, they're not our children. We say that to each other all the time. Maybe she's telling me something by being like, they're not yours. But anyway, just joking. It's a joke. They look, all right, anyway. But they're not, we've said it since day one that they're not our children. They're God's children. We're just trying to steward them for the glory of God. That's been us from day one. It's like, Trey's not ours, JC's not ours, Nora's not ours. Yes, they look like us. Yes, they act like us. Yes, they talk to us. But everything we have belongs to God, and we're going to use it for His glory. We're just trying to steward for His glory when it comes to our money, when it comes to our homes, our cars, our family, our jobs. It's all for God's glory. See, we can't lose this idea. Solomon, as we're reading through this, remember last week I told you this is a poem. This is a poem that Solomon wrote in his older years of life. Looking back, he wrote this beautiful poem, and he keeps saying this thing over and over. He says, under the sun, under the sun, under the sun. Because the poetic justice of this is he has found meaning. He has found joy. He has found contentment. But it wasn't under the sun. It was over the sun. It was in God. It was in the one who created the sun. That's the beauty of this all. Wise men learn from their mistake. Wiser men learn from the mistakes of others. This beautiful poem is Solomon going, learn from me. Verses 12 through 17. So I turned to consider wisdom and madness as folly. So I'll sum this up real quick, okay? So we don't have to read through it. But what he says in verse 12 and 17, he said, wisdom and fools both die. You can be the wisest man to ever live. You can be a fool and you both die. You can have every degree and every letter behind your name that's ever been. And you can be me. And you both will end up dead. And he's like, what's the point of the wisdom? He literally says, what's the point of this wisdom I've been given? What's the point of it all? But then he makes this crazy, crazy statement in verse 22. Look at verse 22. Can you get that up on the screen? Not verse 22. I'm sorry. Verse 17. He said, I hated my life because what is done under the sun was grievous to me. For all the vanity and striving after the wind, he basically says, I worked so hard to have all this. And I realized that everything under the wind, everything under the sun doesn't last. But what does last? That which is over the sun, which is God. He keeps giving us this hope. Look at verse 18. I hated my toil in which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to man who will come after me. So he's talking about his inheritance. He's talking about his kids. He said, who knows whether he will be wise or a fool? Yet he will be master of all which I have told and used my wisdom under the sun. This is vanity. He basically saying, look, man, I've worked so hard. I've done all these things. I've built these great kingdoms, and my children could waste it away. You know what the sad thing is? If you read the scripture, his children wasted it away. And this is why his children wasted it away. I'm going to get real honest with mom and daddies and mom and papas here real quick. You ready? Solomon allowed idolatry and sin to come into his home. And it may not have affected him as we read this, but it sure affected his children. Mom and daddies, mom and papas, your sin may not be affecting you, but it will affect your children. You need to handle it. You need to handle it and not let it in your home, because the kingdom was lost because of what Solomon allowed in. So he turned about and gave my heart up for despair over all the toil and all my labor under the sun. There it is again. Because sometimes a person who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skills must leave everything to be enjoyed by someone who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What has a man from all the toil and striving heart with which he had toiled beneath the sun? For all his days full of sorrow, and his work is vanity. Even in the night, his heart does not rest. This also is vanity. He says something that really grabbed me. He says, even at night, his heart does not rest. Solomon experienced what I think a lot of us experience. And what is that? Sleepless nights. Anybody ever experienced a sleepless night? Anybody? Yeah? Okay, y'all are a lot better as humans than I am. Okay. Well, I did something about a week and a half ago to help me with sleepless nights. Because the problem is, as I'm thinking about work, I'm thinking about church, I'm thinking about all these other things, and I can't really sleep. And I know some of y'all can relate. You didn't raise your hand because you're scared and you're Baptist. But you can raise your hands in church. But some of you ladies, literally last night, you were listening to him snore, and you were thinking about all that you have to do and how stressed you are. And he's just over there getting it, you know? And you wanted to hit him in the face. Some of you women are looking right at your husbands. Chill. But I started, about a week and a half ago, I started something that has helped me out tremendously in sleeping. And it's not melatonin or magnesium. I know y'all are like, you should try it. I do try it. Jessica has But when I take that stuff, I have the wildest dreams. The other night, me and Obama were duck hunting. That's it. I was dressed like Yosemite Sam. He was dressed like Obama. We were duck hunting. Figure that one out, psychologist, right? I promise you it's that stuff you got me taking, all right? But what I've done a week and a half, though, I've done something. I took my phone and I put it in the living room and I charged it. Because Ross is right. If you text me or call me or email me, I have a compulsiveness in me that I want to be your pastor. I want to get back to you. I don't want to leave you waiting. But I realize what's happening is that some of you, because you're not saved, wake up before 5 a.m. And I know you're like, I'm going to get up and meet with Jesus. Well, I'm going to tell you what, Jesus is still there at 6 a.m. I'm telling you. All right, but some of you like to wake up at like 4:30 or before 5 and start sending me text messages. This just blessed me, thought of you, Pastor. And I'm laying in bed going. And then some of you like to stay up till like 2 o'clock in the morning and talk to Jesus. And you like to text me the same thing. So I realized I gotta sleep. So I took my phone and put it out in the living room and I charge it there. And I'll be honest with you, I'm sleeping like a baby. Because you know why? I don't hear this all night. That's the men's Bible study, by the way. But you know what? Solomon talked about this, and it's that idea, that restless night. Is that because here's what's happening. I believe it's in all of America, and it's really striving. And Solomon's saying right here, workaholicism will kill your family. Because even when you're there, you're not there. You're too busy thinking about other things that you should be. Workaholic, thinking about work, you're going to miss family dinners. You're cheating yourself out of sleep. You're cheating yourself out of these things because you're missing ball games. You're missing church. You're missing all these things because if you can just get ahead, listen, I'm telling you right now, it's not worth it. The most important thing in my life is my family. A couple weeks ago, we've had really busy weeks, done a lot of weddings, had some traveling, had some things here at church, Western Carolina, all these things going on. And me and Jessica have really tried to strive. I love this, but we try to have family dinners. No phones, no TV. We let Alexa play so the government can hear us. But we, other than that, we just sit there and we eat dinner and we laugh and we tell stories and we spend time together. And it's the greatest thing ever because we're trying to enjoy what God has blessed us with. And if you're not taking time to do that, then whatever you're doing in replace of that is not worth it. If you're like, but Brian, I got to just work harder so I can get this, so I can have this. Why? Because the Joneses have it? Listen, the Joneses aren't saved. They're going to hell. I'm just joking. If your name's Jones, you are a wonderful member. No, but I'm saying we spend so much time because if you get to what the Joneses have, guess what? Then there's going to be the Smiths, and then there's going to be the Thompsons, and then there's going to be Ross Horton. Might as well give that up. Do you see his arms? I mean, unbelievable. Like, but here's what Solomon's saying. You can chase all of it. You can miss sleep. You can stress. But it's all worthless. It's all vanity. Now, this is a poem. This is a poem, and he's talking about everything under the sun. And then look at verse 24. Let's sit in verse 24 for a second. He turns and says, there is nothing better for a person that he should eat or drink and find enjoyment in his toil. This also I saw is from the hand of God. For apart from him, you can eat or who you can have enjoyment. For the one who pleases him, God has given wisdom and knowledge and joy. But the sinner, he is given the business of gathering and collecting only to give to the one who pleases God. This is meaningless. It's like striving after the wind. He makes this pivot, this poem, where he's laying out all of these things. And Solomon's saying, I chased after all of these things. Young men, this is a great book for you to understand because you can chase after everything the world is trying to tell you you need. And it will end empty with nothing unless it's for the glory of God. And if it's for the glory of God, verse 24, enjoy it. Go after it. Eat, drink, be merry. Why? For the glory of God. You're like, but you just spent 2 weeks telling us not to do all these things. I didn't say that. I said, don't do them for your own pleasure. Do them for the glory of God. Do it for Jesus' name. Paul lays it out perfect in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31. He says, whether you eat or drink and whatever you do, do for the glory of God. Listen, it's the Jesus factor. When you do it for the Lord, you can enjoy it. Because guess what? When you're doing it for the Lord, it's not for under the sun. It's for above the sun. It's for the thing Solomon's been talking about. It's for God. If you have a job and you want to succeed and you want to get that promotion, you go after it for the glory of God. Don't sacrifice your family, don't sacrifice, but for the glory of God. If you want that bass boat, if you want that ski boat, go get it for the glory of God. Take your pastor. Do it. Chase it. If you want to build the house, me and my wife, we have a beautiful home. It looks like a fellowship hall because it is. It's for the glory of God. We want people there so we can study the word, so we can pray, so we can work through things. It's for the glory of God. All that we have, yes, we can enjoy life for the glory of God. Here's the hard part. Here's where we're getting. You ready? The problem is this thing called sin in Genesis 3. And here's what the ultimate sin is. The ultimate sin is not smoking and drinking and cussing and dipping and dating girls that do. That's not the ultimate sin. The ultimate sin is that you want to be God. And you are under the sun. That's what it comes down to. So you take these things meant for good, these pleasures meant to be used to glorify God, and you turn them about you. So ultimately what you're doing is you're saying, God, just move over here. I'm going to take this spot. Some of us even take God and make him a pleasure to make us feel better. Hey, I came to church. If you don't know him, it don't matter. Listen, the ultimate sin we all struggle with is that we want to be God. So let's get all the way back to chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes, this unbelievable book that holds a mirror up from this man, the wisest man that ever lived. Late in his years of life, he's writing this beautiful poem, and here's what he's saying. He was saying, I tried to be God, and I came up empty. Ours may not be as big as Solomon. But all of us in this room, every single one of us in this room, every single one of us listening online, we come to a point in our life, or we're in the middle of a point in our life, where we're trying to be God. That's the fall of man. That's the fall of man. And it will leave you empty because you can't be him. You're an image bearer. You're not the image. So how do we make this right? How do we find this? How do we not just be meaningless? What really is all this for? It's all to bring God glory. How do we do that? We confess our sins. We confess. We admit it. We admit it. We repent. We admit, listen, all of us, I talked to you at the very 20 minutes ago, I told you we're all in this room and we're all acting like we're good. Here's the thing, we're not good. I'm not good. I sin daily. Yeah, I may be better than you, but I'm still not good. We're all struggling with sin. No sin is greater than the other. We all struggle. I struggle. I told you last week about a struggle this week. But here's what I try to do. I try to do what David did. I try to do what this beautiful poem does, is when it's brought to my attention, I repent and I run from it. And I say, God, I'm so sorry. And I want to be more like you. We sing songs up here. I want to be where you are. Do you really want to be where he is? Because if you want to be where he is, you're going to have to get rid of something. And we had to move things out of our life to put him as the centerpiece. We had to move our schedule so that we can make sure that we're in church and we're studying the Word of God. We got to move our daily lives so that we can maybe get up a little bit earlier so we can spend time in his Word and hear from him and what he wants us to do. We're going to have to do something. You don't just kind of sit. But you're not working for your salvation either. It's a gift. It's understanding the grace. It's because you feel his love and understand his love that you feel and understand that your life has a greater purpose than anything under the sun, that is for something above the sun, something eternal that's going to last forever. That's going to motivate you. You want to do whatever you can to be close to him. I want to be where you are, Jesus. But so many of us, just like Solomon, we just get lulled into this thinking that other things matter that don't. So what is it? As Katrina comes to sing, what is it? What have you allowed to come into your life that's keeping you from experiencing the fullness of his grace and his mercy? See, Jesus doesn't require you to do anything but accept the offering that he paid for you. See, you want to be God. And those things that you've put in your life are things called sin, because the centerpiece of those things aren't God, but they're yourself. And what Jesus came to do is say, you know what? We've all done that. He said, we've all done it except me, but we all done it. And Jesus said, I'm going to take this. I'm going to take the debt you owe. Now I'm going to die on a cross so that you can be made right with God. And you can live a life not searching after the things under the sun, but using those things under the sun to bring me and my Father glory. Pointing your life, everything is meaningless without Jesus, but with Jesus, everything can be enjoyed. You can live a fun, good life. Well, I don't like church because all they do is tell you you can't have fun. I'm telling you, have a good time. If you're around me, we're laughing. I'm going to make fun of you. You're going to make fun of me. We're going to have a good time. We're going to goof off. I try to be a lot of fun. You want to know why? Because I want to enjoy life. Because God told me to, for his glory. Because I found freedom in him. I found freedom in his grace and his mercy. Have you? Have you ever trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Do you have a relationship with him? Do you have freedom in the gospel? And if you do, then what is distracting you from living every day like that? What have you allowed to creep in? And we all have it. We all have that thing. Every one of us have that thing. Let's confess it. Let's lay it before Jesus so that we can be what we're called to be. Because guess what? We want to be where he is. Because that's where freedom is found. That's where life is lived abundantly. Father God, I pray. I pray that life change happens right now, Jesus. God, I pray in this room that there are men and women that are willing to learn from the wisest man on earth, and they see the things that they're chasing and how they're coming up short. And we confess and we put you, God, as the thing we're chasing. That we want to be where you are. That the only thing that matters more than anything else in our lives is our relationship with you. And it all comes down after that. It all trickles down into every other avenue of our life. If you are the centerpiece, Jesus. Father, I pray right now that sins are confessed. I pray that life change happens. Lord, I pray right now if there's someone in this room that doesn't know you as their personal Savior, that today that they would admit that they are not God, that they are a sinner, that they would believe fully in you and in the gospel, and that they would commit their lives wholeheartedly to you today. And in this room right now, I pray someone is praying that prayer. Online, someone's praying that prayer. But for the rest of us that may know you, Jesus, Lord, let us be moving the things out of the way that distract us. Let us move the things out of the way that are meaningless. And let us only see you in your goodness and your grace. Would you stand with me as we sing this worship song? The altar is open. I encourage you to come to the altar. There's prayer cards. What is God doing in your life? If you're like, I'm good, then you just sing this over the people around you, because God is working in this place.
And I call. You answer.
Father, we want to be where you are. Meet us where we are. And we know you love us so much that you chase after us. You're relentless, Lord. And I thank you for the prayers that have been prayed today and the life changes happened. But let us not keep it to ourselves, but let us share it. Let us share what you're doing in our lives, Lord. Let us share your gospel to the world. And Lord, I just pray that you meet us so that we can find the meaning of life. And it's you, Jesus. It's above the sun. Lord, I thank you so much for your goodness and grace. In Jesus' name, amen. There's two things I want you to do. I challenge the first service. I'm going to challenge you guys. If you're in the room and you're a guest, I'd love for you to fill out a Connect card. I really would. We're selling it to China. That's how we pay for the fire truck outside. All right? I'm just joking. We don't do that, but it's a way for us to connect with you. But here's the next thing. I challenge the first service. I challenge you to do something. Me and my wife, we take this very seriously. Here's what I want you to do. Even if it's a bowl of cereal or a grilled cheese sandwich, I want you to make time this week to sit down with no phone, no TV, and have a meal with your family. Have a meal with your family. We've lost that. We lost that. Sit down. Even if it's a bowl of cereal, cut the TV off and just sit. And you're like, it's going to be awkward. Absolutely. You say, but it's just me and my husband. It's just two of us. That's fine. You say, but I live alone. You have friends that you spend time with. There's something beautiful about sharing a meal together. And if you want to make it even more, get some Capri Suns and a loaf of bread and take communion. But just take time to talk about Jesus with your family. And just cherish the moment. Because it's a beautiful moment. It's a beautiful moment. Just sit and eat. And some of you are going to go do it right now over chips and salsa. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.